Hello everyone, welcome to this session on the brainstem. In this session, we'll be quickly revising all the components of the brainstem. Okay, so which all are the parts of the brainstem? Here we can see the image of the brainstem viewed from the anterior aspect. So this cranial most part of the brainstem, this is the midbrain. In this middle part, this is the pons, and the lower part of the brainstem, this is the medulla oblongata, okay, which will continue as the spinal cord below. Okay. So in this session, I'll be covering all the three parts of the brainstem under these standard headings: the external features of that part, the internal features, as well as the applied anatomy. Okay. External features of all the three parts of the brainstem I'll cover together, and internal features we'll see one by one along with the applied anatomy. Okay. So let's begin with the external features. Here we can see the brainstem viewed from the anterior aspect, brainstem viewed from the posterior aspect. Okay. So we'll cover external features from below upwards. So here this is the medulla oblongata viewed from the anterior aspect. The anterior most structure here which is seen, this is the anterior median fissure. Okay. And just lateral to it, this structure is the pyramids. Okay. And so just lateral to it, there is an elevation which is referred to as olives. And lateral to it, there is inferior cerebellar peduncle. Okay. And in between the pyramids and the olives, this groove which we can see, this is the anterolateral sulcus. And between the olives and the inferior cerebellar peduncle, there is posterolateral sulcus. Okay. And this anterior median fissure, when we trace upwards, there is a small depression here. This is the foramen cecum. Okay. So these are all the features in the anterior aspect of medulla oblongata. Let's see the features along the posterior aspect of medulla oblongata. If we see the posterior aspect, we'll observe that the lower part of the medulla oblongata is a closed part and the upper part of medulla oblongata is a open part. Okay. The features of the closed part which are seen on the posterior aspect are, this elevation is the gracile tubercle, and just lateral to it there is cuneate tubercle. Okay. And in the open part, it's actually a part of the fourth ventricle. Okay. So when you study the external features of the posterior aspect of pons and the medulla oblongata, so most of the structures are included in the floor of the fourth ventricle. Okay. That we'll be covering later on. And the demarcation between pons and medulla oblongata is by wide band of fibers, which will be visible here. So those are referred to as stria medullaris. Okay, below it is medulla oblongata, above it is pons. And let's see the features of the pons along the anterior aspect. So there will be transverse striations which will be seen because of the transversely running pontocerebellar fibers. Okay, and this on the lateral aspect, there is middle cerebellar peduncle. Okay, junction between the pons and middle cerebellar peduncle, there is a nerve which exits from the pons, that is the trigeminal nerve. Then along the midline, there is a shallow groove which is referred to as basilar groove, which lodges the basilar artery. Okay. Then midbrain on the anterior aspect, here we can see the cerebral peduncles, okay, on each side. Then midbrain seen from the posterior aspect, there are four rounded elevations. These four rounded elevations, the upper two are referred to as superior colliculus, lower two are referred to as inferior colliculus, okay, and all four together are referred to as corpora quadrigemina. Okay, then separating this colliculus, there is a cruciform sulcus. Okay, like a cross, there is a cruciform sulcus which separates these four colliculus. When we trace this vertical limb of the cruciform sulcus upwards, it will reach towards the pineal gland, and when we trace it downwards, we'll reach towards the superior medullary velum, which forms the roof of the fourth ventricle. Okay, so these are all the features along the posterior aspect of midbrain. Okay, and when we study about the brain stem, the study of attachments of the cranial nerves are also important. In all, there are 12 pairs of the cranial nerves, out of which 10 pairs of the cranial nerves, they are attached along the brain stem. Okay, so which 10? The third, and the fourth cranial nerve, they are related with the midbrain. Fifth cranial nerve, as we discussed, the trigeminal nerve. Then sixth, seventh, and eighth. These three cranial nerves are at the pontomedullary junction. Along the medial aspect, there is sixth nerve, that is the fifth, abducens nerve, and seventh and the eighth, the facial and the vestibulocochlear nerve, they are along the lateral aspect of pontomedullary junction. Okay, then the last four cranial nerves, 9, 10, 11, 12, these two cranial nerves are related with the medulla oblongata. On the anterolateral sulcus, there will be attachment of the 12th nerve, hypoglossal nerve, and posterolateral sulcus will give attachment to this remaining three nerves, 9th, 10th, and the 11th cranial nerve. Okay, so 12th nerve along anterolateral sulcus, 9th, 10th, and 11th nerve along the posterolateral sulcus. Okay, so with this basic idea, let's cover the internal features of the brainstem. So while studying the internal features, there are 7 sections of the brainstem which we need to study, out of which 3 sections are in the medulla oblongata, 2 sections are in the pons, and remaining 2 sections are in the midbrain. Okay, so we'll study one by one, and we'll study below upwards. Okay, first we'll study the lowermost section of the medulla oblongata, and lastly we'll go up to the section at the superior colliculus of the midbrain. Okay, so let's start with the section of medulla oblongata at this lower level. This lower level is at the level of pyramidal decussation. Okay, there are decussation of the pyramid, and there's a level just above it, there is sensory decussation, and there is one level at the level of the olive. Okay, so three sections we need to study in medulla oblongata. Let's start with the first section. So here this image shows the section of the medulla oblongata at pyramidal decussation. Okay, so when we say pyramidal decussation, we will have to show decussation of the pyramids in this section. Okay, so what do we mean by decussation of pyramids? Here we can see the white matter fibers pyramids, which are on the anterior aspect, they are crossing. Okay, so this crossing we will have to show in this section, and after crossing they continue as the lateral corticospinal tract. Okay, about 75% of the fibers they cross. Okay, and the remaining they continue as the anterior corticospinal tract. And while studying this section, this section will look similar to that of the section of the spinal cord. Okay, the spinal cord, if we take section at the cervical level, this will look similar to this section. Okay, here we can see the central gray matter, the peripheral white matter. Okay, so in the central gray matter there is nucleus gracilis, nucleus cuneatus, and lateral to it there is spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve. Okay, then this gray matter is separated from the central gray matter by this decussation of the pyramids. Okay, this is the detached anterior horn which is seen. Okay, and apart from that, which all structures are seen in the white matter? These two yellow colored structures, these are the spinocerebellar tract going towards the cerebellum. Then there is lateral spinothalamic tract. Okay, and these are the reticular formation which extends throughout the brainstem. Okay, so few structures you will find in all the sections, and there will be some specific structures with respect to that section, so that is must when you draw a diagram at that particular level. Okay, so this was section at pyramidal decussation. Let's try to recollect the various structures in an unlabeled image. Here we can see an unlabeled image, section at pyramidal decussation. So as per the name, first we'll have to draw the pyramid, then show the decussation of the pyramid, and because of this decussation, the central gray matter separates the anterior horn. Okay, this is the detached anterior horn. The remaining part of the gray matter is nucleus gracilis, nucleus cuneatus, and spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve. Okay, then in the white matter, this is lateral corticospinal tract, and these two are the spinocerebellar tract, and this is spinothalamic tract. Okay, lateral spinothalamic tract, and this is the reticular formation. Okay, so all these structures are important in section at pyramidal decussation. Now let's cover the section at the sensory decussation. So again we will have to show decussation of the sensory fibers. Which sensory fibers? Here we can see the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. They end in this nucleus, nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus, and from there the internal arcuate fibers, they cross, and they after crossing it will ascend up upwards as the medial lemniscus. Okay, so this crossing over of the fibers we will have to show, and this crossing is in such a way that the medial fibers are related along the anterior aspect of the medial lemniscus and the lateral fibers are along the posterior aspect of the medial lemniscus. Okay, the medial fibers, they represent the fibers of the lower limb. Okay, so the lower limb is represented along the anterior aspect of the medial lemniscus. Okay, then the gray matter, it is not seen as clear as that of the previous section. The various nuclei are separated. These two nuclei we have already seen, and this nucleus was also seen in the previous section, spinal nucleus and tract of trigeminal nerve. Okay, and these things are also common. Okay, the things which are common, I won't repeat it much. So spinocerebellar tract, spinothalamic tract, okay, and reticular formation is also common. Then along with the nucleus cuneatus, there is small nucleus which is referred to as accessory cuneate nucleus. Okay, in the floor of fourth ventricle there is a structure called as stria medullaris, right? So fibers of those arise from this accessory cuneate nucleus. Okay, then along the anterior part, this is pyramid, and a small portion of this inferior olivary nucleus is also seen, but major portion of this will be seen in the section which is higher up, that is section at the level of olives. Okay, then apart from that, in the central gray matter, three important nuclei are seen. This nuclei is, this is the hypoglossal nucleus, then dorsal nucleus of vagus and nucleus of tractus solitarius. Okay, in the central gray matter, these three nuclei should be shown. Okay, hypoglossal, dorsal nucleus of vagus and nucleus of tractus solitarius. The central opening is the central canal of the medulla oblongata. It's actually the central canal of the spinal cord which extends upwards. Okay, and this pink colored structure which is seen, this is the medial longitudinal fasciculus. Okay, this structure connects the 3rd, 4th, 6th, 8th, and 11th cranial nerve. Okay, the 3rd, 4th, and the 6th cranial nerve, they are responsible for the eye movements. 8th cranial nerve is responsible for hearing and balance, and 11th cranial nerve is responsible for neck movements through the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Okay, so this medial longitudinal fasciculus helps in coordinating the actions of these 5 nerves. Okay, so let's quickly recap this section in an unlabeled image. Okay, so this section is at the sensory decussation. So in this section we will have to show the decussation of the sensory fibers. So these are the internal arcuate fibers arising from nucleus gracilis, nucleus cuneatus, there is accessory cuneate nucleus and spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve, spinocerebellar tract, lateral spinothalamic tract, reticular formation. Okay, this is the medial lemniscus, some part of inferior olivary nucleus. The pink colored structure is the medial longitudinal fasciculus, and three nuclei are seen in the central gray matter. From medial to lateral, these are hypoglossal nucleus, dorsal nucleus of vagus and nucleus of tractus solitarius. Okay, let's cover the next section now. So this section is at the level of olives. So here we will have to show the inferior olivary nucleus very clearly. Okay, and just adjacent to inferior olivary nucleus, there are few other nucleus as well: dorsal accessory olivary nucleus, medial accessory olivary nucleus. Okay, then the three nuclei which we saw in the central gray matter in the previous section, they are spread out in this section. So this is the hypoglossal nucleus, dorsal nucleus of vagus, nucleus of tractus solitarius. Okay, all these three nuclei we saw in the previous section as well, and just lateral to it there is vestibular nuclei. Okay, then few other nuclei, the nucleus ambiguus, then final nucleus and tract of trigeminal nerve. Okay, and there are three structures shown near the midline. labeled as 1, 2, 3. 1 is the medial longitudinal fasciculus, which we saw in the previous section as well. There is tectospinal tract and medial lemniscus. Okay, and here we can see the formation of vagus nerve as well. Okay, and this section is very important as far as the applied anatomy of medulla oblongata is concerned, because if there is a vascular lesion of medulla oblongata involving this area, okay, I'll just shade this area to show you. So if there is a vascular lesion, it will involve all these structures. Okay, one structure we missed, this structure is the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Okay, so whenever there is a vascular lesion in this area, so all these structures, we should know that these structures are present: the dorsal nucleus of vagus, tractus solitarius, spinal nucleus, and tract of trigeminal nerve. Okay, depending upon the structures involved, we'll be able to tell about the clinical features in that particular condition. Okay, and similarly, there is one clinical condition which involves this medial area. So if medial area is involved, so what all structures are affected, we should know, and depending upon that, clinical features will be able to tell. Okay, so let's first quickly revise this section in an unlabeled image. So this section is at the level of olives, so we will have to show the inferior olivary nucleus, and there's some accessory nucleus as well, and these three nuclei which was seen in the previous section as well: hypoglossal nucleus, dorsal nucleus of vagus, nucleus of tractus solitarius, and spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve. This is the vestibular nuclei, the nucleus ambiguus. Nucleus ambiguus is nucleus for the 9th, 10th and the 11th cranial nerve. Yellow color is the spinocerebellar tract, green color is the lateral spinothalamic tract. Okay, and these 1, 2, 3 labeled are medial longitudinal fasciculus, tectospinal tract, and the medial lemniscus. Okay, and these are the pyramids. Just in front of the pyramid, there is small gray matter that is referred to as arcuate nucleus. Okay, now with this basic idea, let's cover the applied anatomy of medulla oblongata. So as I told you, there is one clinical condition which involves this posterolateral aspect, and one clinical condition involves the medial aspect. Okay, we'll see one by one. So here we can see the lateral medullary syndrome, which involves the posterolateral aspect of the medulla oblongata. It is also referred to as Weilenberg syndrome. The blood vessel affected here is the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Okay, so which all structures are affected here? Spinothalamic tract, if it gets affected, it will lead to contralateral loss of pain and temperature in the trunk and the limbs. Okay, then spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve, if it gets involved, it will lead to ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature over the face. While telling about the clinical features in the brainstem, we should always speak about which side is affected. For example, if opposite side is affected, the word will be contralateral. Same side is affected, the word will be ipsilateral. Okay, then nucleus ambiguus, if it gets involved, it will lead to ipsilateral paralysis of muscles of palate, pharynx and larynx. Okay, why? Because this is the nucleus for 9th, 10th and the 11th cranial nerve. Okay, then inferior cerebellar peduncle, if it gets affected, it will lead to ipsilateral ataxia. Then vestibular nuclei, affection will lead to giddiness. Okay, this was all about lateral medullary syndrome. Then let's see the medial medullary syndrome, also referred to as Jerrine's anterior bulbar syndrome. Artery involved here is the anterior spinal artery. Then various structures affected. The pyramid, here we can see the pyramid which is affected. Then there are two other structures which are affected. One is the hypoglossal nerve, which will lead to ipsilateral paralysis of the tongue, and medial lemniscus will lead to contralateral loss of position and vibration sense. Okay, and pyramid, if it gets affected, it will lead to contralateral hemiplegia. Okay, so this was all about the two syndromes. There are few more applied anatomy with respect to medulla oblongata that also we'll cover. One is the injury to the medulla oblongata. It's fatal because there are many vital centers in the medulla oblongata, like cardiac center, respiratory center. Okay. Then there's something called as bulbar palsy. In bulbar palsy, the last four cranial nerves are affected. Why it is called as bulbar palsy? Because medulla oblongata is also referred to as bulb. Okay, its shape is like a bulb, so that's why it is also referred to as bulbar palsy. And there is one tumor in relation with the medulla oblongata called as medulloblastoma. It's actually a tumor of the cerebellar vermis, which compresses along the vital centers of the medulla oblongata. Okay, this was all about medulla oblongata. Let's move on to the pons now. So pons also two sections will be covering, one at the lower level, one at the upper level. We'll see the names of each of them and various features. The section at the lower level is referred to as section at facial colliculus. Okay. So here we will have to show the facial colliculus in this section. And facial colliculus is formed by this nucleus of the abducens nerve as well as the winding of the facial nerve. Okay, so these two structures we will have to show here. Then apart from that, the vestibular nuclei is seen, then cochlear nuclei is seen. Okay. And in general, if you see the section of the pons, this up to this part, this is the tegmental part, and this part is the basilar part of the pons. Okay. And here we can see this is the medial lemniscus, then spinal lemniscus, then spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve. And this is the trapezoid body. Okay. And in the basilar part, there are longitudinal bundles of corticonuclear and corticospinal fibers, pontine nuclei, and transversely arranged fibers are the transverse pontocerebellar fibers. Okay. And this MTR is common from the previous section. The medial longitudinal fasciculus, tectospinal tract, and reticulospinal tract. And there is inferior cerebellar peduncle as well. Let's try to identify the various structures in an unlabeled image. So here we can see the facial colliculus has to be shown here. Then nucleus of abducens nerve, facial nerve. Then MTR, that's the medial longitudinal fasciculus, tectospinal tract and reticulospinal tract. And there is vestibular nuclei and cochlear nuclei. Okay. This is medial lemniscus, and spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve, and the trapezoid body, corticonuclear and corticospinal fibers, then pontine nuclei, transverse pontocerebellar fibers, okay, and inferior cerebellar peduncle. So all these structures are seen. Okay. And as far as applied anatomy of pons is concerned, this section is very important. Because just like in medulla oblongata we learnt with respect to the specific area, there are clinical features. Similarly, for this section is also important. We'll see the applied anatomy later on. Before that, first cover the section at the trigeminal nucleus. So this section shows the main sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. Trigeminal nerve is actually a huge nucleus having part in the midbrain as well, part in the pons as well, and part in the medulla oblongata as well. Okay. This section shows the sensory nucleus, and sensory as well as the motor nucleus. Both nuclei are seen here, and in between them there is mesencephalic root of the trigeminal nerve as well. Okay. And this we have already covered. And these four lemnisci are seen, the medial, trigeminal, spinal and lateral. From medial to lateral you can remember as MTSL. Okay. And while speaking about the lemnisci, the functions of each lemnisci you should be knowing. Medial lemniscus, as we all know, carries fibers of fasciculus gracilis cuneatus, so is responsible for 2-point discrimination, vibration, position sense. Okay. And trigeminal lemniscus carries pain and temperature of the face region. Spinal lemniscus carries pain and temperature of the body and the limbs. And lateral lemniscus, it is a part of auditory pathway. So functions of all four lemniscus we should know. then this part is common from the previous section, and this is the middle cerebellar peduncle and superior cerebellar peduncle are seen in this section, and this is the cavity of the fourth ventricle. Okay, this is covered by the roof, that is the superior medullary velum. Okay, so all these things are seen in this particular section. Let's again try to recap in an unlabeled image. So the all four lemnisci we will have to show in this section. Then trigeminal nerve nucleus, the motor nucleus, sensory nucleus, and mesencephalic root we will have to show in this section. Okay, then middle cerebellar peduncle, superior cerebellar peduncle, then medial longitudinal fasciculus, tectospinal tract, reticulospinal tract, small part of trapezoid body is also seen. Okay, and this is the basilar part of the pons. So all these features are in the section in the upper part of the pons. Let's cover the applied anatomy related to the pons. So as I told you, there is an area which is involved here in this syndrome called as Millard-Gubler syndrome, and posterior lateral aspect is affected in pontocerebellar angle syndrome. Okay, we'll see the cause and the clinical features. Miller-Gubler syndrome, in this the artery involved is basilar artery. Okay, basilar artery will supply this region, right? So this is affected, the abducens nerve is affected, which will lead to ipsilateral medial squint. Okay, abducens nerve supplies the lateral rectus muscle, so if it gets paralyzed, so the eye will move medially, so that is ipsilateral medial squint. Involvement of facial nerve will lead to ipsilateral lower motor neuron types of facial palsy. Then corticospinal tract involvement will lead to contralateral hemiplegia. Okay, then pontocerebellar angle syndrome, this is not due to any blood vessel, this is due to pressure on the pons by acoustic neuroma. It's a tumor in that region. If it compresses upon the pons, it will lead to these clinical features. So there's compression of this nerve, eighth cranial nerve, the facial nerve. We know at the pontomedullary junction along the lateral aspect there are 7th and the 8th cranial nerve. Okay, so if that gets compressed, it will lead to corresponding clinical features. So vestibulocochlear nerve, if it gets compressed, it will lead to tinnitus, progressive deafness, and vertigo. Okay, facial nerve, ipsilateral lower motor neuron type of facial palsy. Cerebellar peduncle, compression leads to ipsilateral ataxia and staggering gait. Then spinal nucleus and tract of trigeminal nerve is involved here, that will lead to ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature of the face. Okay, this was all about pontocerebellar angle syndrome. Few other applied anatomy with respect to pons. One is pontine hemorrhage. When there is bleeding inside the pons, it will lead to pinpoint pupil, hyperpyrexia, deep coma. Okay, then bilateral paralysis of face and limbs, a very serious condition. And tumors of the pons, astrocytoma is one of the noted tumors. And there are two other syndromes with respect to pons. One is Fowle syndrome, in which the dorsomedial pons is affected. So in the dorsomedial pons, there is abducens nerve nucleus, facial nerve nucleus. Okay, so clinical features will be according to that. Raymond syndrome is basal pontine vascular lesion. It is similar to that of the Millard-Gubler syndrome. Now let's cover the midbrain. So midbrain also, there are two sections, one at the level of inferior colliculus and one at the level of superior colliculus. We'll see one by one. So before studying the sections proper, let's have a brief overview of how a section of the midbrain looks like. In general, we can say there are two parts in the section. One is the tectum and other is the cerebral peduncle. Okay, and this demarcation is at the level of cerebral aqueduct. Okay, also called as aqueduct of Sylvius. Okay, in front of it there is cerebral peduncle, which further has got three parts: the tegmentum, substantia nigra, and the crust cerebri. Okay, so this dark colored structure, this is the substantia nigra. In front of it there is crust cerebri, and this entire area is the tegmentum. Okay, let's cover the section at the inferior colliculus. The name itself suggests inferior colliculus, that means we will have to show inferior colliculus in this section. Okay, apart from that, this nerve has to be shown, trochlear nerve. Trochlear nerve is shown at the section of inferior colliculus. Oculomotor nerve is shown at the section of superior colliculus. This difference we should know. Okay. And this all four lemnisci, which we saw in the previous section, so that all four lemnisci are seen. And this MTR we have already covered. Then in the central gray matter, there is trochlear nerve nucleus and mesenchymphalic nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. Okay. Remember about the trigeminal nerve, I told you it has components in midbrain, pons as well as medulla oblongata. Okay. That's why it is seen here. And this opening is the cerebral aqueduct. And there is decussation of the superior cerebellar peduncles, which are seen here. And this black colored structure is the substantia nigra. And this is the crust cerebri, which is having various fibers. Along the lateral aspect, you can remember the fibers as POT, okay? Parietopontine, occipitopontine, and temporopontine fibers. POT. So that's easy to remember. Okay? And then along the medial aspect, there is only one type of fiber, that's the frontopontine fiber. Then intermediate part, this intermediate part is the large part, two-third part, okay? The lateral and medial are 1/6 and 1/6. Intermediate part, there is corticonuclear fibers, corticospinal fibers of the pyramidal tract. Okay. So this was all about this section. Let's quickly recap in an unlabeled image. Okay. So section at inferior colliculus, we'll have to show inferior colliculus, then the trochlear nerve. It's actually crossing over before it exits from the midbrain. That's the only nerve which exits from the dorsal aspect of the brainstem. Okay, rest all of the cranial nerves they are exiting from the ventral aspect of the brainstem. Then the four lemnisci, MTSL, which you can see here. This is the reticular formation. And MTR we have already covered. This is the decussation of superior cerebellar peduncles. Okay, then this is the substantia nigra. The crust cerebri showing three parts and fibers. Okay. Let's cover the section at superior colliculus. Alright, so superior colliculus, we will have to show the superior colliculus as well as there are a few other key features to be shown in this section. One is the red nucleus, another is the oculomotor nerve. Okay. In the previous section, we had shown the trochlear nerve. In this section, we will be showing the oculomotor nerve. Okay. Then in the lemnisci, only three lemniscus is seen. The lateral lemniscus is not seen. Why it is not seen? Because it has relayed into the inferior colliculus. Okay. Because the lateral lemniscus is a part of auditory pathway. So those fibers has went through the inferior colliculus. So that's why it is not seen in this section. Okay. Then mesenchymphalic nucleus of trigeminal nerve is common. It was seen in the previous section as well. And this part is also common, the crust cerebri substantia nigra. Okay. Then there are two decussations which are shown, the ventral tegmental decussation of forel and the dorsal tegmental decussation of maynut. Okay. And for applied anatomy of this midbrain, this section is very important. We should know that which structures are in the tegmentum of the midbrain. So depending upon the structures, we'll be able to tell about the clinical features of the patient. Okay, let's cover the applied anatomy. Before that, first quickly recap the unlabeled image. So this shows the superior colliculus and the red nucleus, oculomotor nerve. These three are the main things which should be shown. Then the three lemnisci, medial, trigeminal, spinal. Then this nucleus is the oculomotor nerve nucleus. This is the mesenchymphalic nucleus of trigeminal nerve, and there is a small nucleus which is shown here as the pretectal nucleus. Okay. And this is the reticular formation, and these are the two decussations, ventral tegmental decussation, dorsal tegmental decussation. Okay. And this crust cerebri and substantia nigra, this was covered previously. Let's cover the applied anatomy of the midbrain. So just like I told you, specific areas we should know. Which structures are in the tegmentum of the midbrain and which structures are in the anteromedial aspect. Okay, so this area is involved in Leber syndrome. This area is involved in Benedict syndrome, and there is one syndrome called as Peyronnet's syndrome, which involves the folliculus of the midbrain. Okay, involvement of this area causes abnormal gaze. Okay, and these two syndromes we'll study in details. So Weber syndrome, it is caused due to the branch of the posterior cerebral artery. So here we can see the area which is affected. So corticospinal tract will be affected. So that will lead to contralateral hemiplegia. Here you can see the oculomotor nerve as well. So it will lead to ipsilateral lateral squint. Okay. And then Benedict syndrome, it's caused due to the paramedian penetrating branches of the basilar artery. Okay, because the penetrating branches will involve this area, that area, the tegmentum of the midbrain. So which structures are there? Red nucleus, if it gets involved, it will lead to contralateral force tremors. Then involvement of oculomotor nerve is common in Benedict syndrome as well, in Weber syndrome as well. Okay, then involvement of medial lemniscus, it will lead to contralateral loss of position and vibration sense. Okay. So this was all about the three parts of the brainstem with external features, internal features and applied anatomy. So for PDF handout, you all can WhatsApp me at this number, and please do watch the other sessions of this YouTube channel.